Spirit, living breath of God, breathe new life into my willing soul. Bring the presence of the risen Lord to renew my heart and make me whole. 'Cause your word to come alive in me, give me faith for what I cannot see. Give me passion for your purity. Holy Spirit, breathe new life in me. Souls the path of peace, turn my striving into works of grace. Breath of God, show Christ in all I do.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to our online service recorded down at the church here at Great Vic. Wherever you're tuning into this today, you are so welcome. We are emerging gradually as a church out of lockdown, and we had a really encouraging time last Sunday evening as we met together here at the building for a short communion service and some time around God's Word. We'll be doing so again this evening at 6 p.m. down at the church. So please do join us if you're feeling ready to do so. You would be more than welcome. For now, our morning services will continue like this online, but we do hope to be able to get back down to the church on a Sunday morning soon. We are so eager to do so. Well, we're here this morning, gathering wherever you are to worship the Lord. In Isaiah chapter 66, verses 1 and 2, we read these wonderful words. Thus says the Lord, heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. What is the house that you would build for me, and what is the place of my rest? All these things my hand has made, and so all these things came to be, declares the Lord. But this is the one to whom I will look. He who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word. Let's pray together as we start this service and come before our holy God. Father, as we gather in our homes or wherever we're watching along or listening along to this, may your spirit enter in like a fresh breeze, bringing freshness and new life to each of us in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing now this wonderful hymn, Be Thou My Vision.
See you.
together, and we're going to use a prayer from Ephesians chapter 1 as the outline of our prayer this morning. Let's pray. Our Father, we come to you, the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, and we ask that you would give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of you. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we want to know you more. Father, we want to enjoy your love. Lord Jesus, we want to enjoy your grace. Holy Spirit, we want to enjoy your comfort. Spirit of the living God, we ask that you would enlighten the eyes of our hearts, that we may know what is the hope to which you have called us, what are the riches of your glorious inheritance in the saints. Father, we want to grow in our understanding of the treasures we have in your Son. We want to be truly broken over our sin. We want to really confess and feel our repentance. We want to know the fullness of forgiving grace. We want to know the incredible hope ahead of us. Father, we want to know the immeasurable greatness of your power toward us who believe, according to the working of your great might that you worked in Christ when you raised him from the dead and seated him at your right hand in the heavenly places. Father, we want to know that resurrection power of your Son in us. We want you to help us, Lord, to overcome our sin and our laziness and all that besets us. We want to grow in holiness, in the blessing of the anointing of your Spirit. We want to be more like you, and we need power and help from your Spirit for this. Lord, we pray for our land this morning, asking that you would pour out your Spirit and bring a great awakening of grace. We pray for our church family. We pray for all of those who heard the word through the Bounce Holiday Bible Club outreach this week. Thank you for the team who worked hard to put the online teaching together. Thank you for all those who were able to access that. And we just pray that you would continue to sow the seed of the gospel through that program and through those videos. Keep it going, Lord, and may the ripple effect be broad. This morning, Lord, we just ask that you would meet us where we are. In our struggles, in our joys, in our encouragements or discouragements, wherever we're at, meet us, Lord, and draw us nearer into your great love. For, Lord, we need you more than anything else, and we ask for more of you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Rosemary now is going to read for us from Luke's Gospel, Luke chapter 18. So if you have your Bible, do open it and be ready to follow along.
The reading this morning is taken from Luke chapter 18, verse 9 to 14. He also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you that I am not like the other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week, I give tithes of all that I get. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted.
Forever.
Let's pray briefly now as we come to God's word. Father, again, as we open your word and come to listen to you speaking to us through your word, we do ask that you would speak, Lord, for we, your servants, are listening. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, if you have your Bible, please do open to Luke 18 and be ready to follow along this wonderful parable that Jesus taught, the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector. In the year 1859, an American civil rights leader named Frederick Douglass delivered a rousing speech before the students of the Indian Industrial School of Pennsylvania. His goal in the speech was to inspire the students gathered to hope for a better future. The title that Douglass gave to his speech was this: Self-Made Man. In the midst of the speech, he said these words: "It will be evident that allowing only ordinary ability and opportunity, we may explain success mainly by one word, and that word is work. Work, work, work. He who does not think himself worth saving from poverty and ignorance by his own efforts will hardly be thought worth the efforts of anybody else." Now, there's so much in Douglass's speech that is true and rising and that can be applied to lots of areas of life in a helpful way. It is good to work hard and to pursue success in our work. Of course it is. But there is one area in life, in fact, the most important area of life, where Douglass's philosophy simply won't work. And that is in the area of gaining success with God. When it comes to standing in a right relationship with God, there are no self-made men or women. There are only grace-made men and women. And that truth really is the main message of the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector that we're looking at this morning. This is a parable that addresses perhaps the most important question we can ask in this life, and that is the question, how can I be approved by God? How do I know that I'm okay with God and that God is okay with me? This question is important for every one of us this morning. Now, the parable in itself that answers this question is short and simple. If you look down at it there, you'll see in verse 9, we're given the reason for the parable, the problem of self-made righteousness. Then in verses 10 to 12, we're given an example of self-made righteousness in the Pharisee. This is how not to go about being right with God. Then in verse 13, we see an example of grace-made righteousness in the tax collector. And this is how we should seek to be right with God. Then in verse 14, we get Jesus' conclusion to the story and the lesson. Not self-righteousness, but self-renunciation is the way to being right with God, to finding approval with God. So let's just walk down through that simple outline together. First, starting at verse 9, where we get the reason for the parable, that is the problem of self-made righteousness. Look at verse 9. "He also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt." Now, this opening purpose statement makes the coming parable relevant to every one of us listening today. Why do I say that? Well, because this is a parable dealing with a need we all have, and that is the need for approval. Now, where do I see that? I see that in this word, righteous, in verse 9. Jesus tells this parable so that he can speak to those trusting in themselves that they were righteous. Now, that word righteous means essentially approved. It means wanting to know that we are in the right, that our life counts as good, a good life. And if you think about this for just a moment, this need for approval is universal. It's something every one of us are seeking pretty much all the time. Just the other day, for example, I was praising our son Elliot for being kind. And I said, "Elliot, you're such a kind boy." Our wee daughter Grace overheard, and she just looked at me and said, "But Daddy, what about me?" All through life, from birth to the grave, it's like we're all wearing t-shirts with the slogan, "Affirm me," written in big writing all over them. Affirm me. It's often why many people document their whole lives on social media in the pursuit of likes, follows, and retweets. It's so often why we worry about what people think of us. This need for approval is at the heart of so much of our insecurity. We are all starving for affirmation and approval, and it seems like we can never get enough. We're never satisfied. And so we have to ask ourselves right at the outset here, where does this need for approval come from? Well, in the Bible, the answer to that question is clear. This need for approval traces its origins all the way back to the Garden of Eden, where Adam and Eve rebelled against God and first experienced shame and sin. You see, we were made in the beginning, created by God, to enjoy a sense of approval from being in a right relationship with God, a sense of peace, well-being, that all is well. We were made to enjoy a sense of approval from God. Because of our sinful rebellion against God, though, our relationship with God was broken. So we lost that sense of everything being okay within us. The absence of God's approval has left what we could call an approval vacuum in the heart of every one of us. This emptiness within means we're constantly hungry, constantly seeking affirmation from others. We seek to impress, we seek to earn affirmation, but this is exhausting and ultimately does not work. Why? Because we seek to fill our need for approval space with that which does not satisfy. Seeking to earn approval just on the horizontal level will never work because it will not sort out the source of our insecurity, and that is our broken relationship with God. Covering our insecurities with compliments will never satisfy, because the approval vacuum can only be filled by knowing or regaining approval from God. So if you're seeking to gain a sense of approval and rightness just in this world, gaining it from others complimenting you or you impressing them, it will never work. Because that big hole, that vacuum left within that makes you crave approval, only God can fill it. And so Jesus is speaking here, we're told in this introduction, to people who are seeking a sense of approval in themselves. He's speaking to those who are seeking to earn affirmation and a sense of rightness. He's addressing the problem of self-righteousness. seeking approval by ourselves, trying to earn it, gain it. And he's addressing the symptoms that so often accompany self-righteousness. And that is a sinful looking down on others who aren't as impressive as we are in the eyes of the world. So verse 9 gives us this clear reason for the parable. He told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. And now he moves on then to give straight away an example of self-righteousness, someone pursuing this sense of approval in their own efforts. This opening introduction to the Pharisee, this is teaching us how not to go about being right with God. So the parable begins in verse 10. Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. Now, in this day, the Pharisees were the guys who were seen as being in with God. They were religious, they said the right things, and they looked authentic. They walked the walk of religion, they talked the talk of religion. The tax collectors, on the other hand, were known as not being in the right with God. They were known for being sinful and greedy and usually had no room in their thoughts for God. And this is why it is so shocking that the Pharisee here in Jesus' story is the example of how not to pursue approval with God. This Pharisee is an example of one who doesn't understand grace. And in its day, this would have been so shocking because people saw the Pharisees as the, wow, the religious one. Well, in verses 11 and 12, Jesus tells us of three things the Pharisee does and says that shows his attitude towards seeking approval before God is all wrong. First, in verse 11, Jesus tells us that the Pharisee stood by himself or prayed with reference to himself. We're to see in this little detail that this guy, the Pharisee, thinks he is in a league of his own. He takes center stage. He wants people to see his piety, to see his prayerfulness. Jesus is clearly showing that the Pharisee is totally self-focused. Five times, the Pharisee fits in the first person pronoun, I, in his prayer. Did you see it? I thank you. I'm not like other men. I fast. I give a tithe of all that I get. He wants others to approve him, this Pharisee, and say, wow, what a godly guy. Others looking on in admiration gives this Pharisee a sense of pleasure or pride. Others approve him, and he feels good about it. He's made his ministry all about himself, and he doesn't even say it. That's challenging. Second thing Jesus tells us about the Pharisee, we're told that he bases his sense of approval on comparison with other people. Look at how he prays in verse 11. God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even this tax collector. This is the sort of guy who is always evaluating himself against what he sees in others. If he sees really gifted people, he feels bad about himself and threatened and inferior. If he sees others that he evaluates as less godly than himself, he sees himself as the righteous one that others can learn from, and he feels good about himself. He looks at his efforts of righteousness, and he really believes that he's doing well, and he may well be, but his heart is all wrong. For him, others are rivals that he has to beat in a holiness competition. I wonder, do you ever do this? Do you ever measure yourself up against others and see them as a threat or a rival in some subtle way? That's not love, that's self-centeredness. The third thing Jesus says about the Pharisee then is that he bases his sense of approval in external acts of righteousness, boxes that he can tick that make him feel good with God. You see how Jesus is communicating this clearly in the parable. Notice that the Pharisee's thinking about righteousness is all external. He thanks God that he doesn't steal, doesn't commit adultery, and doesn't practice injustice. But notice he doesn't seem to think on the inner character level at all. He doesn't thank God that he's growing in how much he loves, or in how patient he is, or that he's seeing kindness grow in his life. No, his view of sin is totally external. Sin is a problem out there, not a problem in here to the Pharisee. So he reasons that if he can just do the good things and avoid the bad things, he will be approved by God. And so he doesn't just focus on what he doesn't do. He moves on in verse 12 to call attention to what he does do. He says, I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all I get. Now, what the Pharisee says here is really telling. He does something here that we must be careful not to do. Notice he is finding confidence and identity in actually going beyond what is written in Scripture. Now, when he speaks of not stealing, not being unjust, etc., they are all things clearly commanded to avoid in the law. But when he says, I fast twice a week and I give tithes of all I get, that was more than what the law commanded. He was going above and beyond the call of duty. Now, of course, it is fine to be as devoted to the Lord as we can. We don't just do the bare minimum so that we can walk with God. It's fine to be devoted. It's fine to be as devoted as we can be to God. But this Pharisee's problem was that he was setting up his own personal discipline and his own personal preferences as a standard so that he could look down on others. He was beating down others with his own religious preferences and his own religious discipline. Now, those are the three things that Jesus is pointing to in telling us this story about how the Pharisee was mistaken in the way he was seeking approval with God. But let's just for a moment pause before we look at the tax collector. Let's do what's, to be honest, rather painful here. Let's take a look in the mirror of God's word and let's see if we're in any way guilty of doing what the Pharisee did. I want to ask just three application questions now to allow the challenge of Jesus' parable here to land on us. Question one, do we ever find ourselves more concerned about what people see than about what God sees? There's an old sitcom called Father Ted, and I don't think everyone would appreciate it here, but there was a couple who were always fighting in this sitcom. It would always be the husband and wife, always arguing, always fighting, always at each other's throats. But when they would bump into the minister, suddenly they'd pretend that all's well. And they'd be like, oh, Father Ted, how are you doing? It's lovely to see you. And the husband would put his arm around his wife and pretend that all was well. They were acting, putting on a religious show in front of this so-called godly minister. I think we have to ask ourselves, are we ever guilty of putting on a bit of a religious show, more concerned about what people see than about what God sees? Do you remember how the Lord spoke to Samuel when Samuel was called to anoint David? Samuel was impressed by the outward appearance, what he saw in Jesse's strapping young lads. But God said to Samuel, remember Samuel, God does not look at the things man looks at. Man looks at the outward appearance. Man looks at the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. Jesus in this parable is trying to subtly invite us away from that bondage of trying to play act in front of other people. And he's inviting us to be real and authentic as Christians. This means we are called to simply be real in our relationships with one another. This parable challenges us to live our lives not primarily before the audience of this world, but to live our lives before the audience of one. Thinking more fully, what does God see? And then second, about what do people see? So we have to ask ourselves, do we fall into the trap of the Pharisee? He just stood in the middle in the platform and he was so concerned about what everyone saw. He just wanted everyone to think, wow, what a godly guy. Do we think like this? Second question. Do we ever base our approval with God on external acts of righteousness? Do we ever think that by our efforts of righteousness and right living, that those efforts actually gain us acceptance with God? Do we ever fall into this trap? Now, we must be careful here. We've got to be nuanced in the way we think of this application. We can fall into a legalistic trap that reading our Bible, praying regularly, fasting, giving, we can think that all of this gains us extra points with God, gets God to like us more. We can actually turn our religious acts of devotion into a works-based religion. Remember, that's the subtle shift the Pharisee made. His religious acts of devotion weren't flowing out of a heart of love and life in grace. He felt that this is what he had to do to gain approval with God. And if we're not careful, we can turn our kind of acts of devotion, Bible reading, prayer, church attendance, commitment, we can turn this all into some kind of works-based system that makes us think that all of that makes God love us more. And we can forget that our standing with God is established on the basis of Christ alone. That's how we're made sons and daughters of the living God. That's how we are declared righteous, on the basis of Christ's finished work on the cross alone. So we must be careful not to allow our religious devotion, our acts of righteousness, to slip into a kind of legalism. If we don't read our Bible this morning, or we don't pray as regularly as we like to sometimes, we start to feel so guilty and feel that God doesn't love us and like us anymore. And that's misunderstanding the gospel. But then straight away, we have to say on the other side, we can overreact against legalism. We can start to say, oh, I'm saved by grace, so I don't have to really worry too much about the disciplines of grace and religious devotion. We can start to say, oh, I'm free. I don't have to read my Bible every day. Don't be so legalistic. You don't have to worry about prayer. Don't be so legalistic. And then our lives can actually start to lose focus and discipline, and we get careless as Christians. We just think, I don't really have to worry about church, don't really have to worry about my Bible or prayer or giving. I'm saved by grace. And then we just get sloppy in our Christian lives. Before you know it, you drift away from God in the name of grace, being free. And so I think we need to be nuanced and wise here. The question I'm asking is, do we ever base our approval with God on external acts of righteousness? We need to be balanced. We need to tell ourselves daily, my standing with God is all of grace. Yes, I am declared righteous today, not on the basis of my religious performance, but on the basis of Christ's life, death, and resurrection. Absolutely. But at the same time, if I'm going to walk with God, I do have a responsibility to be disciplined, to focus as a Christian. I want to read my Bible regularly to feed my soul. I want to pray. I want to be present at church. I want to give, because this is what it is to live a life worthy of the calling we've received. So, in light of that, let's pray that our devotion would be grace-driven, not guilt-driven or legalism-driven. If you're truly hungry, pray for an appetite for God, because if you're truly hungry, you don't need to be forced into getting up to open the fridge to get something to eat. Pray that God would put an appetite in your soul for Him, and that all your religious devotion would flow out of that longing for Him, not a sense of legalistic guilt avoidance. So do we ever base our approval with God on external acts of righteousness? We have to ask ourselves that and move away and live again in that place of grace. Third question I want to ask. This is pointed, so let's think carefully. This is a sharp application that really does cut deep. Reflecting on the Pharisee, do we ever, like him, set up our religious standards and preferences and use them to look down on and judge others? I'm going to read that again. Reflecting on the Pharisee, do we ever, like him, set up our own religious standards and preferences and then use them to look down on and judge others? Another way to ask that question would be, do we ever go beyond what is written and then use that standard to oppress others? How might we be guilty of doing this? Well, let's think of a few ways we may fall into this trap of doing this. For example, when we decide that there is a certain way to dress for church, and then we look down on others who don't think the same as we do. Another way to do that, when we insist that our view on drinking alcohol is the right one, and then we look down on anyone who thinks differently. Or when someone believes we should worship with exuberance, when someone loves to worship with their hands stretched out high and they'd love to just clap and sing and praise the Lord with exuberance, when we believe that's how you should praise God, we can look down on others who don't think that's how you should praise God. And we think of them as superficial. Or when we believe that you should worship God with a more reserved nature, with solemnity, and you should just quietly contain yourself and bow your head and enjoy the Lord without exuberance. And then you look at all those who get carried away with emotionalism and you judge it as superficial. And you just set your standard and your preference up and you look down on others. Or when those who are closed to spiritual gifts look down on those who are open to them. Or when those who are open to them look down on those who are closed to them. We can even put pride in the translation of the Bible we use and look down on others who don't use our translation. Isn't that ridiculous? That we would in some way set this standard up and say, because I read the King James only, or the ESV only, and I look down on everyone else that reads any other version of the Bible, we go beyond what is written, and then we make our standard a standard by which we judge and beat down others. Listen, it is as serious to go beyond what is written in the Bible in that sinful way as it is to do less than what is written in the Bible. Here's how you hold a balance. You do what the text says. You stick to the Word of God. Not trying to go beyond what is written to beat down people. Not doing less than what is written. You stick with the text. And you build your whole life on walking in the text. Now, there are loads of questions, loads of caveats we could give to that, but we just don't have time to do so now. The point here that Jesus is making in this parable, he wants us to know that the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking and external acts of devotion primarily, but it is of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. And in that righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit, that's from that heart flows all of our acts of devotion and love. And then we never set up our standard of devotion as a standard by which we beat down and look down on others. No, we seek to love and care and inspire and build up and encourage others. We're not seeing others as our rivals that we have to beat in a holiness competition. No, we seek to love and build one another up, not look down and fight with one another. There's been too much of that in Northern Ireland denominationalism over the years. Too much Pharisaism. And Jesus would call us away from that. The Pharisee is a subtle example of how we can actually look religious on the outside and yet be seeking approval with God in all the wrong places. Search your heart this morning and confess before God where you've been acting or thinking like this Pharisee. And now, just briefly then, as we move to a close, let's see the contrast to the Pharisee who sought approval with God in himself, in his own efforts. Let's see the contrast now, the example of a grace-made man, the tax collector. This is how to find approval with God. Look down at verse 13 with me. Now we get such a powerful contrast to the Pharisee in the tax collector. As we were given three things that the Pharisee said and did that exposed his inner attitude, now we're given three things that the tax collector says and does that exposes his heart attitude before God. First, we're told that the tax collector stood far off. He wasn't concerned about what people saw in him. He didn't want to take center stage so that everyone could see him praying piously. He wanted to get away from the crowd, to be alone so that he could get real with God. His focus was on the audience of one. This was not someone wanting to make a religious show. This was someone who wanted to get real with God. Second, we're told that he didn't feel he could even lift his eyes to the heaven, but he beat his breast. Now, these were the actions of one truly broken, contrite, and sad because of seeing the sin in their own heart. This was one who was broken and one who was expressing broken-hearted sorrow over sin. One who knew that he could never gain by his own self-effort approval with God. And he knew that he couldn't do that because of his big problem of his sinful heart. Third thing Jesus tells us about this tax collector is that he renounced self-effort and self-approval and sought his approval solely in the mercy and grace of God. His prayer was simple and genuine. God, be merciful to me, the sinner. Now, the word behind mercy, be merciful, is a very rich word. It's in the group of words that is translated elsewhere in our Bible with this old word, propitiation. That's an old word that means turning aside anger. It's an asking of God to cover over our sins. Forgive me. Let me know the smile of your approval. That's what the tax collector's praying as he prays, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. He's not just saying, oh Lord, just forget my sins as if there were nothing. He's saying, Lord, pay my debt, cover my sin, deal with all the ways in which I have fallen short of your glory and your standard. All my anger, all my self-righteousness, all my pride. Lord, just see all of the debt and take it all away from me. My only hope is your mercy. All I can hope on is you being merciful and turning aside your anger and smiling upon me in your grace. I can only hope in your mercy. That's all I've got. And what does this powerful contrast of the tax collector with the Pharisee teach us? Well, simply this. True approval before God, the only approval that really matters, is not found inside ourselves, it is found outside of ourselves in God. You won't find approval in your own efforts, in mustering up strength so that you can try and be an amazing person and impress everyone so that they'll look at you and think, wow. That will never satisfy you. It will exhaust you and make you incredibly insecure. True approval and peace for your soul is found when you renounce that self-effort and that self-attempt at gaining approval in the eyes of everyone else, and you say, God, I'm tired with this. My own efforts, they always fall short. I am hoping in you alone for grace, mercy, and forgiveness. The forgiveness that comes through Jesus Christ. That's the only way I can be approved with you and be free from this constant effort and exhaustion at trying to impress everyone all the time. True approval is not earned. It is received by grace as a gift. Did you hear that? True approval is not earned. It is received as a gift from God, and it comes to you when you receive Jesus Christ. True approval is not found in chasing compliments and in being well thought of by people. True approval is found in totally renouncing self and receiving the mercy of God. There is such freedom when you do that. God sent his Son into the world to be our sacrifice, our propitiation, the one who would pay our debt to open our way to receiving approval with God. You will find approval with God when you stop trying to gain your approval everywhere else and you see that in Jesus, you're made right with God. And that big hole, that big vacuum of approval that makes you starve for the compliments of others, God can fill that and set you free. This is liberating, it sets us free, and boy, it humbles us deeply. And so the parable concludes in verse 14. It was the tax collector who went down to his house justified. That means approved, rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. Here is how to be approved in the eyes of the one who matters most, God. Stop trying to earn it and receive his approval as a gift by turning away from your sin and saying, Lord, have mercy on me, the sinner. That's how you receive approval, justified, you're made right with God, the only one whose approval truly matters. And then be careful, because you know it's easy to then fall into the trap and say, oh Lord, I am thankful that I receive mercy like the tax collector and not attempting to do it for myself like the Pharisee. Be careful that you don't then fall into a trap saying, oh, I get grace, and all those legalistic people don't. Be careful. Let's live in the place of grace. So back to the speech that we started with by this man, Douglas, the civil rights ambassador. He said in that speech on the self-made man. It will be evident that allowing only ordinary ability and opportunity, we may explain success or approval by one word, and that word is this: work, 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 work. That's what the world would tell you. Jesus, in this parable, tells us true approval, the approval that comes from God that will satisfy the deepest longings of your soul, is found in one word: grace, 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 grace. Let's pray. Oh, our Father, we thank you so much that by grace, the free gift of righteousness, approval before you, comes to us through Jesus Christ. By our own efforts, we will never be declared righteous. It is only when we renounce self-righteousness and we throw ourselves on the hope of your mercy and forgiveness and grace alone, that's the only way we can be approved before you. And so for everyone watching this or listening to this today, I just pray that right now we would confess our sins where we have been like this Pharisee. Even if we think of ourselves as Christians and there are areas of our lives where we're being like this Pharisee, falling into the trap of thinking again that we gain your smile by our religious efforts and not solely on the basis of your grace. Oh Lord, forgive us for this. But help us to be balanced. Then we don't just get sloppy and say, oh, it's all of grace, so I do nothing. Give us wisdom to know how we ought to live. But for the person listening this morning who knows that they have been trying to gain approval by earning it, either in the eyes of this world or earning it with you by thinking, oh, if I just live a good life, that'll be enough. May the parable of Jesus this morning come with fresh power, and by your Spirit, may you expose to that person that their efforts in themselves, in their own attempt at righteousness, they will never gain approval with God. The only way to gain that approval and righteousness with God is to renounce self-effort and to hope solely in the righteous gift of Jesus Christ. And may we receive Christ again this morning and know that our right standing with you is built not on our performance, but on Christ's performance. We receive Jesus again this morning and we give you thanks for him. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're going to respond now by singing, Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. We read in this hymn that it's not the labor of our hands that won't fulfill all of God's demands. Could our zeal no respite know? Could our tears forever flow? None for sin could atone. It's only by grace that we are saved. So let's respond and sing this in our hearts before God. Thank you. as we close. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Amen. Thanks so much for following along with us this morning. If you've been particularly touched or challenged in some way through the word, please don't hesitate to get in touch with us. The details will be on the screen after the service closes. Do feel free to get in touch with us. We'd love to be able to follow up with you and encourage you more in the Lord. Thanks for listening along. Enjoy the rest of your day. God bless.